Well, good evening to you. Thank you for being here tonight, and to those who are watching, grateful for that as well. As we begin this evening, just a couple of announcements for us this midweek time. First of all, if you need a listening guide, they're here. If you want a little prayer guide that we have each week that Miss Amber makes, then you can grab one of those as well. On there, it gives you a couple of announcements that you don't want to miss. First of all, this coming Sunday, we will welcome Jim Collins here. And Jim, I've shared with you, is a dear friend, and he is serving in Northwest New York State in Buffalo, and he's working with our North American Mission Board. And I've spoken to him a couple of times this week already as he's preparing and excited about two things. First of all, he's excited to be here to talk to us about what the Lord is doing in New York in terms of church planting. But secondly, he's excited to be here out of the cold of Buffalo. And so we're excited that he's going to be able to spend a little bit of time with us. Monday, and we'll mention this again on Sunday, but Monday we will have an opportunity. If you care to, you just let me know as soon as you can so that I can make sure that our associational office knows. But on Monday, we're going to have a dialogue time from 10 to about noon, and we'll finish with a lunch at our associational office. Not only will Jim be there, but we also will have with us Jason McNair. And Jason will be in town, and so he's going to share some things from the Idaho-Utah Convention. And of course, our association has been out there doing some just research about how we can connect out there with church planting. So both of those men will be with us on Monday at our associational office for kind of a roundtable dialogue and then lunch. But if you'd be interested in being a part of that, you want to hear more on a personal level what's happening, you want to talk about how that might impact you or someone you know, or how you can be praying specifically related to that, let me know. You can join us at that on Monday from 10 to noon. And then, of course, the other announcement has to relate to Easter, and I can't tell you how much I'm looking forward to that. I'm excited about that. Let me just give you a little backstory of that. When I was talking with our staff, I shared this on that video. I was talking with our staff about that, and we were brainstorming through that, and I asked them to just kind of reach out, talk to some individuals in their ministry areas, and spread it across the church in terms of who you're talking to, and different age groups, and whether or not they're single or married or have kids, don't have kids, whatever it might be. Maybe even some that aren't currently attending, if you can. And so the beauty of that was being able to hear from so many involved in particular ministries. And the one thing that was constant through all the conversation was, I'm excited about the opportunity to be able to see the whole family that will gather. And so we're looking forward to that time of worship. And of course, all the details are here. If you want to have that, all the details are there for that Easter Sunday at 9 a.m. And it's going to be a great time together. Looking forward to praising the Lord. Our choir is planning on being a part of that, and so we're excited about being able to hear them and worship with them. So make sure you grab one of these and talk to someone about that and invite them. Again, statistics tell us that upwards of 80% of individuals who will come to church on Easter, who may not come any other time, will come because they were invited by someone personally to come. And so invite someone to join you at Easter here at First Baptist. Well, let's pray together, and then Alan's going to lead us tonight as we worship together. Father, we thank you for this evening. And just as I look at this prayer guide, I think about those individuals from this church that are serving in ministry around North America, some here in Florida and then scattered across this country. Some have served around the world. And I'm grateful for the opportunity that we have to be an impact through the ministry here. And I'm thankful for what you're doing through our North American missions and Dr. Ezel leading that. And Lord, I thank you for the church planters, and thank you for those who are in positions to help not only assess what's going on, but to be a voice, a conversation, and be a picture of the life of church planting, as well as encouraging and strengthening churches and inviting churches to come alongside new churches. So Lord, I pray that you'd use us, and I thank you for that opportunity that we can be used by you. Look forward to hearing from Jim and what you're doing through the ministry of NAM and our missionaries in New York. Father, look forward to hearing from Jason and how you continue to use believers there in Utah and Idaho to reach believers and to strengthen churches. So, Father, I pray that we would be faithful in our giving and our praying and faithful in our going as you would call us to do so. Lord, thank you for tonight. It is going to be a very tough and sensitive and yet poignant subject for us to address. And Lord, I pray that you give great wisdom and knowledge and understanding, clarity of thought from your word tonight, that we would hear the truth. Not only that, Lord, that we would address in our lives, allow you to address in us that which is in error, Lord, that which is wrong or broken or sinful, and that we might be men and women who indeed, not only in our being, but in our behavior, promote an ethic that is in line with Scripture. And so I thank you for the opportunity tonight for you to teach us. And it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Well, friends, this Sunday and really this week rolls out a very special week in the life of our Lord, Holy Week. It begins with Palm Sunday. So we're going to sing a little bit about that tonight. And some of these familiar songs for many of us for Palm Sunday, thinking about Christ's triumphal entry into Jerusalem. Sing with me, please.
There is strength in the name of the Lord. There is power. Hosanna in the highest, that ancient song we sing, for Christ is our Redeemer, the Lord of heaven, our King. Oh, may we ever praise Him with heart and life and voice, and in His blissful presence eternally rejoice. Majesty, worship His majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise. Majesty, kingdom authority, flow from His throne. to his own, his anthem raise. So exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. His majesty, Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. So exalt, lift up, so exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Worship his majesty, Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings. Yes, Jesus who died, now glorified, King of all kings.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. You know, these days, words like diversity and tolerance have come to mean something very different, I think, than maybe what they used to mean or what we would, how we would interpret those words. But God, friends, God's people are a diverse people. And there's never a I don't think there's a more beautiful picture of that in Scripture than the Apostle John gives us. In Revelation chapter 7, verses 9 and 10, I want to read that to you. After this I looked, John writing this, after this I looked, and there before me was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, tribe, people, and language, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were wearing white robes and were holding palm branches in their hands, and they cried out in a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." But we live in a broken world, don't we? And St. Francis of Assisi, centuries ago, prayed a simple prayer that began with, "Lord, make me an instrument of your peace." And we're going to sing that same prayer tonight as a prayer from our heart that God would just break down walls of racism and hatred and other things that keep us from being truly unified as the family of God. Some of you may know this psalm, but many of you won't. I encourage you, though, the words are going to be behind me as you start picking up, especially the chorus. I encourage you to sing it with me. Instruments of your peace. This is how the chorus goes right here.
Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let your love increase. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Walls of pride and prejudice shall cease. When we are your instruments of peace.
Let's sing that again, church.
Lord, make us instruments of your peace. So where there is hatred, let your love increase. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Walls of pride and prejudice shall cease. When we are your instruments of peace. And where there's hatred, we will sow his love. Where there is injury, we'll be slow to judge. Where there is striving, we will speak his peace to the people crying for release. instruments of peace. So Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let your love increase. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Walls of pride and prejudice shall cease. Oh, when we are your instruments of peace. And where there is blindness, we will pray for sight. Where there is darkness, we will shine his light. Where there's sadness, we will bear their grief. To the millions crying for release, oh, we will be his instruments of peace. So Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let your love increase. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. And walls of pride and prejudice shall cease. When we are your instruments of peace.
Lord, make us instruments. One more time.
Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let your love increase. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. And walls of pride and prejudice shall cease. When we are your instruments of peace. Oh, when we are your instruments of peace. When we are your instruments of peace. Amen.
Thank you, Alan. And that song was chosen particularly because it's a segue for us, a connection point clearly with where we're going to be subject-wise tonight, as we are looking at another entry point or another data point on our line of examining our Christian ethic or what that means. And so tonight, last week we looked at what Scripture would teach us about the poor, about the oppressed, about orphans, and tonight a biblical ethic towards racism and human rights. And I'd forgotten to mention this at the beginning. That's why I slipped out to grab something out of my office as a reminder. Next week, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday evenings, in the big field behind us, where near the stadium, the big field by the stadium, the Suwannee County Ministerial Alliance is hosting what they have titled Park and Praise 2021 Celebration. And they are doing three nights of services. 6:30 is the beginning time. I was told that it would be, since there aren't any lights, it would be done obviously before it got dark, so that you'd be able to get home. It doesn't appear they'd be longer than maybe an hour or so. I say or so, probably or so is more like it. So, I've been asked to preach on Thursday evening, and so I will do so. That will impact us next Wednesday to some degree. I don't know all the other individuals who are participating on the other nights. Don't know all the individuals who are participating even on Thursday night. I know that I'm preaching that night. And so I would encourage you to, if you want to be a part of those, then to make yourself available to do so. I will be here at 6 o'clock if you want to come. We won't have a formal common ground service like we're having right now. But if you are coming at 6 o'clock because that's just your normal time, I'll be in here for about 20 minutes. And if you want to get here, we'll just pray for that evening and we'll pray together for our Easter services. And then we'll be dismissed. If you want to head over there, you're welcome to do so. You don't have to come here. If you want to be a part of those services, just go on over there at 6:30. We'll still have things happening on our campus for our Awana and our students as they are trying to finish up some things. And so, but I wanted you to know about that. I forgot to mention that at the beginning. But so that's next Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday in the field behind us, sponsored by the Suwannee County Ministerial Alliance. Tonight, we're going to look at the ethic or a biblical ethic related to racism and human rights.
We're going to look in James
chapter number 2 when we get to the scriptures in just a moment. James chapter 2. There's not anything I can think of that will rate on the meter that causes such chaos in the current society that we find ourselves living than the subject matter of racism and human rights. It does not matter which arena of society that you are talking about, be it politics, the presidential election that we just came through, was inundated and smothered by the subject matter of racism. Media. It is on a daily basis that we find story after story where the subject matter has something to do with race. Entertainment. And I would connect with entertainment, not just things that you might see on film, but I would connect also things that you might read, is now all about racism, whether it is about seeking to educate or whether it is seeking to cancel books like Dr. Seuss because they're racist. Even in our own denomination, having been set up some 160 or 70 years ago, we still are having almost daily conversations within our Southern Baptist Convention about the subject of racism. In recent days, the horrific murders in Atlanta and in Boulder, Colorado, have revived that language once again. Social media has become a firestorm again about the identity and the motives of the shooters in each location. I would not seek to give either one of those individuals more limelight than has already been given, only to say that the narrative in the conversation is often dictated nowadays by how law enforcement addresses the individual, the perpetrator, the criminal, and even the manner of law enforcement, their actions on how they will respond seems to be the subject of racism. Earlier this week, I was reading an individual, African-American individual who is a conservative, if you wanted to think of that in ideology or politics, conservative, and a very liberal individual was interacting with the other individual and sent a photo on a public social media platform. The photo was of a white hood with two eye holes in it. You and I immediately know, as did the individual who received that photo, what it was indicative of. The individual who sent the photo was a white male with very liberal leanings. The recipient of the photo was an African-American female with very conservative leanings and thoughts and ideologies. The statement made with the photo sent from the very liberal white male to the very conservative African-American female was, "Did you forget this?" or something of that nature. It was a slur of sorts to say you have sold out to the Klan. The platform upon which that conversation, that exchange happened, was made aware not only of the photo, but of the language of what was attached to it, and after a period of time, reported back to the recipient, the lady, the African-American lady, to say, we have investigated and we have found that that photo nor the language is racist. Amazing. All of this just in our little homeland called America. You consider around the world, the married to that, the or connected to that, the human rights violations that we can find documented and we can see. Harvard has within its catalog of information a phenomenal study from a political science research study that commenced a number of years ago and goes up through 2017 and records about 50 years worth of data. When you look at the countries of, for example, Vietnam, Sudan, Myanmar, North Korea, Congo, Iraq, Afghanistan, just to name a few, they lead the table, if you will, of scoring the lowest in terms of measuring the protection of human rights. Or to, I would say it differently, they lead the table of being countries that are most prominent in violating human rights. Human rights protections. In countries that have seen the greatest change for the worse in the last 50 years, that is, countries that have seen the largest percentage drop in protection of human rights, countries like Nigeria, Bahrain, Libya, Congo, and then, of course, the usual suspects that we think of, China and North Korea. Our world is in a mess. And there are some who would say that based on who you are determines whether or not you can even speak to the subject matter at hand tonight. But I would submit to you that the Church of Jesus Christ has a commission and a command to address the issues within the society where she is placed. And we must not ignore the status of humanity in our own locale, but we also must not ignore the status of humanity in other parts of the world, because we believe fundamentally that people are image bearers of our God. So we're going to find tonight that God gives us some direction from James 2. In this country, we have struggled through the days of legalized racism and slavery. We continue to fight against the dark shadows of that from years gone by. I would submit to you that there is no race or ethnicity that has the corner market on racism. The willingness to see another person who has a different skin tone than yours as inferior, or to see yourself as superior, is not reserved to individuals with a certain level of melanin. Let me say it differently. The notion that only a particular race or ethnicity can be racist is in itself a racist statement, and it is debilitating to the conversation. But let's be clear. The Church of Jesus Christ is not in a debate to win a conversation. We are not seeking to control a narrative. We are seeking as individuals to let the Holy Spirit of God control our minds and our hearts and our lives, such that what we believe and what we broadcast and how we behave will be contrary to a broken world and will instead promote healing and open the door for gospel moments. So let me begin with three understandings tonight. I think you have these on your listening guide, if I'm not mistaken. you have these. There are no blanks for you to fill in, but let me just begin with these three understandings tonight, because I am convinced that the church needs to admit error when error arises, when there is no scriptural truthfulness to something. And I want to just for a moment begin by admitting errors that have been in our Southern Baptist churches at times, not in this church that I am aware of. If it is, then please make me aware. First of all, from Genesis chapter 9, this errant and unbiblical teaching about the curse of Ham. There is an old teaching within evangelical Christianity, even within the Southern Baptist Convention many, many years ago, that would say individuals with darker melanin are cursed. And it goes back to Genesis chapter 9, in which the sons of Noah, in Genesis 9, Noah imbibed too much and was drunken and passed out in his tent, and he was naked. And Ham, his son, walked in and saw his father's nakedness. And then his brothers went in, and the Bible tells us that they backed in so as not to look at their father and cover him up. And when Noah was made aware of it, there is the pronouncement of a curse in Genesis chapter 9. And it is in that moment in Genesis 9 that there became an errant and unbiblical teaching where Noah says, "Cursed be Canaan, a servant of servants he shall be to his brothers. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Shem, and let Canaan be his servant. May God enlarge Japheth and let him dwell in the tents of Shem, and let Canaan be his servant." And from that, there is an unbiblical teaching that would suggest that the descendants of Ham are cursed, and because many of the descendants of Ham are those who can trace their lineage to African populations or countries, that they're therefore those individuals from that continent are the descendants of Ham, and they can find themselves then bearing this curse. You got to do a lot of what I call linguistic gymnastics to establish this teaching. First of all, the term in Genesis chapter 9 that uses servant is used in other places in Scripture in reference to relationships, and it is not ever used to what we would refer to in terms of forced labor or how Africans were enslaved. The term was used between Esau and Jacob. The term was used between Joab and David. The term was used between Abraham and the Lord. And in those cases, it was always used not as superior in terms of forced labor, but in relationship in terms of being a servant. Secondly, the mark of Cain. In Genesis chapter 4, there is this moment in which Cain, who murdered his brother Abel, is marked in some way. It says, the Lord said to him, and the Lord appointed a sign for Cain. There is in Christianity, has been a teaching that there are those who have dark skin, and because they have dark skin, they have that because they have been given that as a mark. The mark of Cain was dark skin, they suggest. By the way, the word used here in Genesis chapter 4 nowhere makes any reference to skin tone or color. By the way, the mark of Cain is not at all mentioned about his descendants. And thirdly, the mark was never mentioned as a curse, but the mark was mentioned instead as a protection. Therefore, the Lord gave a sign for Cain that no one finding him would slay him or harm him. Unbiblical, but has been taught in churches, even in the last century. Third mark, third understanding, that is the word of Jesus. I'm going to mention this a little later, but Jesus teaches us the great commandment to to love the Lord our God with all of our heart, soul, and mind, and to love our neighbor as ourself. I would submit to you that no New Testament disciple can flesh out that and advocate for the enslavement or the superiority of one group of people over another group of people. Very difficult for you to biblically line up with what Jesus says in that advocate. So let's look at what James says. And tonight, let's look carefully at what it means to guard against the tendency to be partial or to be discriminatory. Let's look at having a biblical ethic that addresses the current culture that we live in regarding racism and human rights. I want to read James chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. My brethren, do not hold your faith in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ with an attitude of personal favoritism. For if a man comes into your assembly with a gold ring and dressed in fine clothes, and there also comes in a poor man in dirty clothes, and you pay special attention to the one who is wearing the fine clothes and say, you sit here in a good place, and you say to the poor man, you stand over there or sit down by my footstool. Have you not made distinction among yourselves and become judges with evil motives? Listen, my beloved brethren, did not God choose the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he promised to those who love him? But you have dishonored the poor man. Is it not the rich who oppress you and personally drag you into court? Do they not blaspheme the fair name by which you have been called? If, however, you are fulfilling the royal law according to the scripture, you shall love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles in one point, he has become guilty of all. For he who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not commit murder. If you do not commit adultery, but do commit murder, you have become a transgressor of the law. So speak and act as those who are to be judged by the law of liberty. For judgment will be merciless to the one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. And then let me skip down to verse 25. In the same way, was not Rahab the harlot also justified by works when she received the messengers and sent them out by another way? For just as the body without the spirit is dead, so also faith without works is dead. Let me offer four thoughts to us tonight of guarding against the tendency to be partial or to be discriminatory. We must make that guard, number one, in how we show preference to particulars. We must guard against the tendency to be partial or discriminatory in how we show preference to particulars. James begins here with this picture, the glorious Lord Jesus. As if you and I should not miss, and the readers here should not miss, that which is going to guide the rest of what he writes after this is this beautiful picture of the glorious Lord Jesus. The true nature of sinful mankind is seen in how the sinful heart treats those around, including those who are somehow different than the individual, those who might be less fortunate, of a different social status, of a different economic status, of a different race or ethnicity. It is why stories of people who are doing good in the lives of other people are such heart-tugging stories in today's world. It ought not to be that way. Those ought to be the stories that characterize daily life, but they're not. So instead, when you see one of those stories, and you'll find it on Facebook, or you'll find it on Instagram, or you'll find it on Twitter, or you'll just find it on a blog somewhere. Many times, the individual posting that will say something like this: "This story restores my hope in humanity." Why? Because we've become so accustomed to, instead of seeing the good, we've become so accustomed to seeing the pervasive, sinful nature of humanity and how we treat others. And James is clear that the faith in the glorious Lord Jesus and seeking affirmation or seeking partiality with the flesh or with our broken sinful nature is not compatible. The desire of the Christian, the believer, the follower of Jesus, to have that compatibility is going to do nothing but show a compromised faith. And by the way, discrimination is not unbiblical if you understand it. Now, somebody takes that phrase and will pull that out of this entire sermon and they'll post it on the internet and that's all they'll say. But Scripture is very clear that the believer is to be discriminating in reference to doctrinal understanding. We are not to believe every whim of doctrine. We are to have discerning or discriminating minds of knowing what is and is not of the faith. But discrimination that is tainted by evil for the purpose of evil is at its core evil. And to be guided by faulty standards such as a worldly picture of success and prestige, or prejudicial thoughts towards another individual or a group of people or a particular status, demonstrates a compromised and a tainted faith. The glorious Lord Jesus, who after all showed by his own life what our attitude is to be. We only have to turn to Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 through 11, and Paul makes it very clear, "Let this attitude be in you, which was in our Lord Jesus Christ." His role as servant at the last Passover meal, willing to do that which in first century world was reserved for a servant, instead to take off his outer garment and wrap a towel around his waist and to begin to wash the feet of those at the meal. During his mockery and his trials that you and I will focus on in the days leading up to Easter, where he is pictured as that of a sheep who is led to the slaughter, Jesus made it clear in his ministry in the Gospels that his focus was not on the outside, nor was it on the resources that the individual had. Think of it for a moment. He highlighted the widow who put her tiny amount of great sacrifice in the coffer. He knelt down in front of the woman caught in adultery, while the religious leaders had so separated themselves and were willing to destroy her. He called alongside himself not just Matthew, a tax collector, and was willing to eat with tax collectors, but he called alongside himself a man by the name of Judas Iscariot. He met with a man on a road to Damascus who had held the coats of those who were stoning Stephen and bore the name Saul, and said, "Why are you persecuting me?" Warren Wiersbe says it like this: "It is really quite simple. It is really quite simple. Look at everyone through the eyes of Christ. If the visitor or the person is a Christian, we can accept him because Christ lives in him. If he is not a Christian, we can receive him because Christ died for him. It is Christ who is the link between us and others, and he is a link of love. And the basis for relationship with others is the person and the work of Jesus Christ. Any other basis is not going to work. So James reminds us here that even the manner in which we treat individuals and what we try to do to position ourselves with particular individuals because of what we think or what we can gain or how we view them, it only highlights our partiality. We must guard against that partiality, guard against that temptation in how we show preference to particulars. This person because of what they may give to me, or this person because of what they do not have or who they are or what they look like. Secondly, we must guard against it with favoritism towards lined pockets or disregard for less fortunate. Now, you say, isn't that similar? It is similar, but it is not the same. With favoritism, we must guard against with this tendency to partiality and discrimination with our favoritism towards lined pockets or disregard for less fortunate. So James says in the first four verses, let me show you that that's problematic. And beginning in verse 5, 6, and 7, he says, let me show you why it's problematic. It's problematic in the form of some questions I'm going to ask you. So he says in verse 5, here's a question. Has not or did not God choose the poor of this world to be rich in faith and heirs of the kingdom which he promised to those who love him? Verse 6, is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not the rich who personally drag you into court? Verse 7, do they not blaspheme the fair name by which you've been called? You know what those questions do? Those questions force every person who claims the name of Christ to be reminded that we began in the same place. Every disciple of Jesus began in the same place as those who were poor in spirit. We began as an end of those who would recognize our own poverty to the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Yes, we would recognize our utter bankruptcy regarding holiness, that we have nothing. And these questions, they might be characteristic of life before Christ, but should definitely not be descriptive of the devoted follower of Jesus. The individuals identified in these questions, it might be a descriptor of someone who doesn't know Jesus, but they should not be descriptive of one who is a follower of Jesus. There is not a believer who brought anything to the cross and would present it as tribute for why he or she should be saved. There's not anything that you would bring. There's no ethnicity that you would bring to say you deserve it. There is no economics. There is no education. There's nothing that you would bring to the cross and present it as a tribute for why you deserve salvation. So as such, these questions should not be indicative of a person who walks with Jesus. Instead, they are indicative of those who don't walk with Jesus, because those who do walk with Jesus realize that each of us came in the same manner as those who were impoverished and in need of Jesus. We are to take inventory of our own salvation, and we are to recognize from where we have been delivered by the grace and the mercy. When you take inventory of where you've been delivered and how you've been delivered, you and I are better able to take our own actions and our own words and we are to measure those against our Savior. It is nowhere within the bounds of God's redeemed for for one with purpose to express such favoritism or demeaning words or slurs or jokes or behaviors or partiality because we consider ourselves superior or somebody else inferior. It is nowhere within the bounds of God's redeemed for us to express that. We must guard against that. Number three, we must guard against the tendency to be partial and discriminatory by being selective with agape. It doesn't mean we should be selective. I'm saying we must guard against that tendency by being selective when we are selective. Look at what James says. If, by the way, he used that word if in verse 2. In verse 2 he said, if a man comes into your assembly. James was insinuating, it's a rhetorical question. This is what I'm putting, it is going to happen. Verse 8, if, however, you are fulfilling the royal law. What a term. James anticipates an affirmative answer from the reader here. If you are fulfilling the royal law. Well, what is the royal law that he's referring to? Well, Leviticus 19, verse 18 is the royal law. Look at what it says. You shall not take vengeance nor bear any grudge against the sons of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord. Of course, that's affirmed. I've already mentioned that, but that's affirmed by Jesus in Matthew chapter 22, verse 39. The second what commandment is like it? You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Why would James call this the royal law? It's James's way of communicating that this is decreed by the king, or this law is fit for a king. Or to say it another way, this is considered king of all laws. This is what needs not be missed by those who are in the body of Christ. But notice what James does. James turns the attention a bit by pressing the issue further. Not just about being partial, not just about being discriminatory towards another person because of some manner of life, whether it's economics or race or dress or whatever. No, James now points to something that is more foundational in the life of the believer. Obedience to Jesus in all manners of life because of love. If you are fulfilling the royal law according to Scripture, you shall love the neighbor, your neighbors yourself. You are doing well. But if you show partiality, you are committing sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. James says, let me go below the action. Let me go below the demonstration of your partiality. Instead, let me now look at something far more foundational, and that is obedience to Jesus in all manners of life. Walter Kaiser wrote about this with these words. Listen to this. This law is preeminent. For if we are not willing to obey God in the way we act toward other people of other social strata or race, then how can we say we love God? Let me say that again. Read his quote again. This law is preeminent, for if we are not willing to obey God in the way we act towards other people of other social strata or race, then how can we say we love God? This being more indicative of our way of life than a good number of more subtle commands that are more internal. This right here, being more indicative of our way of life than a good number of more subtle commands that are more internal. But you would say, well, Pastor, wait a minute. We are not under law. We are under grace. And I'd say, you are absolutely right. We are not under law. We are under grace. And that's exactly what James is helping us understand. Because James is not talking about salvation. In terms of salvation, you and I are not under law, but we are under grace. But the reality is, James is not talking about whether or not you come, this is how you come to faith in Christ. He's talking about how you act as one who is with Christ. So he says, you and I are to live by this law of liberty. The law that is reflective of God's heart for people, which is not filled with favoritism or partiality or discrimination. This law is followed when the ethic and the actions of Christians extends mercy to people regardless of who they are, regardless of what they offer, regardless of where they've come from, regardless of their status, regardless of their position. And when we refuse to be merciful to others in this manner, he tells us that there is a judgment from God that is merciless. You know what our problem is? We read that at the end of that text in verse 13, and it says, for judgment will be merciless to the one who has shown no mercy. Mercy triumphs over judgment. We spend our time trying to figure out what it means that his judgment will be without mercy. And instead, we ought to be spending our time focused on being those who show mercy. Not trying to figure out what we can get away with and still be okay, but rather instead, what is it in this law of liberty that we have, this freedom in Christ that enables us to and calls us to love people, uphold the royal law, and demonstrate that. By the way, I gave you the term in the point tonight on purpose. If you uphold the royal law, which says you shall love your neighbor, again, that's a form of the word agape. That's why I gave it to you. You know why? Because that picture of that word helps us understand it is acting towards another person with their best interest and mind, regardless, listen, not in order that you might get something back from them, but simply because it is of their best interest. God agapes us. He acts towards us with our best interest in mind. He loves us. He does those things towards us because he has our health, if you will, our best interest in mind, and he calls believers to act that way towards others. Our ethic of who we are is framed in how he has loved us in order that we might love those around us. Let me give you the last one and I'm closing. We must guard against that tendency of showing partiality or being discriminatory by ignoring God's examples for us. We are tempted to be partial or to be discriminatory if we ignore the examples. He gives us a few of these here. I grabbed one of these, and that's Rahab at the end. But he mentions Abraham, by the way. Abraham walked by faith. Do you know what we have to learn in Scripture? That there are often times that when God works through the lives of people that we see in Scripture, we get an insight into their life, not only of the good things that God does and how they walk in obedience, but sometimes we get a great picture of how they walked in disobedience. Don't we? Abraham is the father of the Jews, and yet Abraham walked in such a way that he made disastrous decisions demonstrating he wasn't trusting God. What's the one that comes to mind the most? Abraham and Hagar and the birth of a son named Ishmael. Even though God said, I'm going to give you a son, Abraham said, I'm going to take it in my own hands. I'm going to take it in my own actions and not trust the Lord. And yet we find that Abraham is shown to us time and time again as one who walked by faith. Hebrews points that out. That Abraham was an alien sojourning, looking for a city whose builder and maker was God, believing that God had something in store. And it tells us that it was credited to him as righteousness. David, David, the one who Scripture tells us was a man after God's own heart, the one from whom Scripture always points back, that the Messiah traces his lineage back to. And yet, what did David do? David sought to find a way to cover up his own sin and had no regard for another man's life in so doing. There are times that God would show us his examples in Scripture, all the while not asking us to mimic every activity in that person's life. Rahab, certainly God would not advocate for us in harlotry and prostitution, but he uses this one who is described as a harlot and demonstrating that she was one who was willing to trust and fear the word of the Lord more so than that of the king of Jericho. Somebody said it this way: faith cannot be held together with favoritism. Faith must be held together with deeds of faith. Mere outward religion must develop into a faith that acts consistently with the mercy of God, and faith that plays favorites does not evidence itself in merciful action. What did Rahab do? She's placed here as one who was willing to risk a great deal to express an obedience from her heart. She believed God's word and she behaved in that manner, even though it would cost her, could cost her greatly, her own life. But she was willing to take God at his word and to act with an ethic that was honoring the Lord, even if it was not that popular. Don't ignore the examples God gives us. So let me give you the takeaways as I close. Number one, how sensitive am I to those of various differences and seek to be helpful for their betterment? How sensitive am I to those around me that don't look like me or dress like me, or they're not the same skin tone as I am? And how helpful am I? Number two, am I a bridge builder and a barrier destroyer in this community regarding race and class and social standing, or am I more prone to see walls and barricades? Do I look more for ways to build bridges and tear down walls, or do I simply see them as what they are and leave them there? Number three, in what ways do I see myself as superior to others in my community? In what ways, when you look in the honesty of your heart, you see yourself in some manner as superior to someone else? Number four, how apt am I to address a situation where one is being torn down by jokes, slurs, innuendos? How apt am I to address that as opposed to just ignoring it and letting it go? If the church is going to make a difference in this community in relation to racial reconciliation, human rights, or if we're going to make a difference in the world, then we're going to have to be people who guard against the temptation to be partial. We're going to have to guard against being people who discriminate, because in our heart we become a judge in ourselves, as James says. We're going to have to be bridge builders. We're going to have to be destroyers of barriers that we might be able to come alongside, to stand up, to encourage, to have gospel moments, to do the hard work, to learn from the examples that we have in Scripture. We might honor Jesus. Would you pray with me? God, let's not pretend that in our own community we have no issues that separate us, even within the church. We cannot always address what is thought or said by every single person. We can work hard, though, as disciples of Jesus, by the things that we broadcast and how we behave. To promote healing and open the door for gospel moments. It begins with the transformation and the work that you do within us, across this community, in the churches that you have here, with those from various languages and from various ethnicities, all of us as believers willing to submit to the cross, that you might work through us in what we broadcast and how we behave that promotes healing, opens the door for the gospel moments. I may not be able to control that in another person's life, but Father, I can make sure that my life is surrendered and submitted to you. And I pray that that would be the case for each person in this room. That we would live with an ethic. We would be people who convey. And we would act in such a way that helps open the door of this sensitive subject and very volatile subject for gospel moments. It's in Christ's name I pray. Amen and amen.